Dora, He-Man's twin sister and defender of the Crystal Castle. This is Spirit, my beloved steed. Fabulous secrets were revealed to me the day I held aloft my sword and said, "For the honor of Grayskull!" A few others share this secret. Among them are Lightfolk, Madam Raz, and Cowl. Together, we and my friends of the Great Rebellion strive to free Etheria from the evil forces of Horda.
Hello, this is Optimus Solo, and welcome to the 72nd chapter in our Powers of Grayskull series. With me for this 72nd chapter is the one and only TFG1Mike. Hello.
Oh my god, technology. This Horde technology and Skeletor Snake Mountain technology. Jesus Christ, between the two of us. Holy crap.
No, I don't think Hordak wants us to finish this thing.
We got 10 episodes left to Shira, folks. We got from now till episode 82, and then episode 83 next year starts off new adventures.
Blah. Maybe they're just trying to stop us from getting to that point. That might be what.
Can we just skip right over that and just cut the podcast by like?
No, we got to do it. We got to be completist. But anyways, in this episode of Myths of Etheria, we'll be giving you our thoughts on episode 75, Day of the Flowers, episode 76, Brigis, and episode 77, The Caregiver. So we hope you're ready because it's time to go back to Etheria.
He-Man and I will take care of the guard towers. You get the people out.
Right. Let's go.
Have been raiding our labor camps. I don't have enough workers.
The rebels are no longer a problem. I have made an arrangement with the monstroids.
The monstroids?
Go back to your mines, Orc Captain. Soon you will have all the workers you need.
Yes, your lordship. Thank you.
First up today is episode 75, Day of the Flowers. Air date Saturday, November 1st, or somewhere around there, 1986. Written by Durnford King. That's not a typo, I guess. That's the first time I've ever seen that name, though. While Adora and Adam are celebrating the Day of the Flowers, Orko accidentally makes the Swords of Power disappear. Then Hordak sends the most powerful machines in the universe, the Monstroids, to attack Flower Mountain. We have Hordak, then we have She-Ra, He-Man, Glimmer, Madam Raz, Bo, Frosta, Orko, Broom, and Snout Sprout, as well as Orc Captain Sludge Man, and some monstroids. What did you think of Day of the Flowers?
I was waiting for Monstar to show up, honestly, because holy crap, these are like Silverhawks type sounding characters.
Yeah, they are.
Oh, God. I was not expecting this to be a crossover. I was expecting this to be another Flowers for Hordak kind of thing.
And they don't even give us Perfuma or Flutterina or any of those? Which one's
nope,
the one that always has a flower?
It's all Frosta, Madam Raz, Broom, Adam and Adora. I like this one. It's not my favorite crossover, but it's okay.
It's got some interesting elements as far as having the power swords disappear.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. But I don't know. It should be fine. You got a crossover episode with She-Ra and He-Man. You got an element of the power swords being gone or not at their disposal, so they can't do anything as far as their normal powers. You got Hordak involved. You got, you know, something was just missing. I don't know if it would have been better if we would have got some of the Hordak's minions rather than these monstroids. But something was just missing from this episode for me to put it all together.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'll bring it up now, but I wrote it in my Whispering Woods moments. What is so great about this plot is, you know, you take away the plot devices. You take away their ability to transform into He-Man and She-Ra. Even though Orko did it by accident, you take that away, which basically forces them to go through the story as Adam and Adora, brother and sister, trying to figure things out. I mean, hell, if Marlena and Randor were there, you'd have the Berenstain Eternians. I mean, really, seriously.
Right.
It's just one of those things where that's the greatest thing about this episode is that they took away the power swords. At the same time, what excels in this plot, I think, is Orko's continually, he's not giving up.
Right.
Adam's encouraging him. He's not getting a defeatist attitude. He's not, you know, being a whiny emo Jeremy or Ed Weiner or whatever and just going off and doing whatever the hell he wants. He's, you know, trying his best to fix a, you know, a very simple mistake that, you know, it's not like he went turned evil and wanted them to disappear. No. So that's pretty much of the brother and sister stuff and the Orko stuff. That's pretty much what excels in this for me when it comes to the plot. The rest of it was just weird.
Yeah, and we'll have to get into exactly why and what parts are weird, I guess, as we go forward. So let's go ahead and make our way over to the Whispering Woods for the first time today to see what good things we have to say about Day of the Flowers.
I'm gonna go get that mouse, Algernon.
This is the Day of the Flowers. My brother Adam and his friend Snoutspout have journeyed from Eternia to help celebrate the beauty of our world.
And to celebrate the spirit of the people here on Flower Mountain.
Diddly-boo, diddly-boo, point my finger, make them grow. This is so much fun! Well, now I'll try one blindfolded. Point my finger, dear oh dear, and make those flowers disappear. Nothing happened. Oh, well.
Adora, our village.
Bring him some water.
Adora, they took all the men and boys. We were working in the fields when the monstroids came.
The monstroids! Oh, no!
Hordak must have made an alliance with the monstroids, and there's only one reason he'd do that. To get us.
I've got a feeling they'll be here before long.
Where did Hordak take your people?
To work in the Nucleon mines.
Where you'll all be before this day is done. Connect me with Monstroid Control.
Monstroid Control receiving.
Adora and her friends are on Flower Mountain. I want them all in the labor camps within the hour.
Received.
And one more thing. I want all those flowers destroyed.
Flowers? You want the most powerful machines in the universe to destroy flowers?
You catch on fast. Now get to it.
Yeah.
All right, we find ourselves in the Whispering Woods surrounded by flowers. Mr. TFG and Mike, what did you like best besides what you already gave away as far as the Day of the Flowers?
That's it, really, essentially. I mean, first note, yay, crossover. Second note, everything I just told you.
All right.
The only thing that I thought would have gotten this a little bit better, I don't know if you've ever seen, you probably haven't, but there's an episode of the Justice League cartoon in 2001 called In Blackest Night. This is where it's a Green Lantern, John Stewart storyline where they have talk of the Manhunters, who were the first robots or people that the Guardians, who give the Lanterns their price. They were the first things that the Guardians made, and they thought that they were going to work, but come to find out, you need free will. I was really hoping that the Monstroids would do something similar and basically rise up and revolt against Hordak, because Hordak treated them like shit.
Right.
Like, that would have made this episode, other than the fact that it's a crossover and it has some interesting character development for Orko and Adam and Adora, if the Monstroids, or Monstroids, or whatever the hell they're called, if they had risen up and revolted against Hordak, that would have made this episode a hell of a lot more enjoyable.
Yeah, okay, I can see that too. I did think it was interesting that they started with He-Man and She-Ra right away. They're basically in the first scene, so we don't get any crossing over as far as one.
Right, he's already there, yeah.
He's already there. I have a question, though, for you for Snout Spout. Is he from Eternia or from Etheria? Because in this episode, it stated that he came over with Adam from Eternia. I thought we already saw him in Etheria early on with, like, Frosta or Mista or somebody.
Yeah, he's supposed to be.
So I don't know if that was I don't know if that was a flub by the audio or by the writing, but they say that he came with Adam from Eternia for this episode, which I was like, I swear he's already on Etheria, like that's his home. So I was a little confused as to that backstory between Snout Spout and where he is from. I did like the fact that even Hordak is laughing about these dumb ice donuts.
Yeah.
So that's a way of turning a bad thing into a good thing. At least even Hordak is laughing at how stupid those are. But yeah, that's about it. I mean, it's got a crossover. It's got a cool situation as far as them, you know, not having the power swords, etc. But man, everything else for me is Fright Zone today.
Yeah, according to the general Wikipedia, it does say that his species is Etherian. So maybe because he is a firefighting elephant, maybe he had to go over there and put out a fire. I don't know, and maybe that's why he was coming back. But yeah, the wording on that is so totally off.
Yeah.
What I find interesting reading how they wrote his little, very minute bio on Wikipedia.org, Snout Spout is a fictional character in the popular Masters of the Universe franchise. He is a cyborg with a human body and a metal elephant head. He serves the heroic warriors as a firefighter, his main power being to spray jets of water stored in a special pack on his back from his trunk, which he refills periodically from rivers and lakes. Okay. Which he refills periodically from rivers and lakes. The first thing I think of is the TLC song Waterfalls.
Oh, Jesus. Going old school on this. Ice donuts and waterfalls, though.
There's no school like the old school.
Let's go to the Fright Zone so we can. It seems like we're already there. So, as far as Fright Zone, number one, why are those swords just on a random table sitting there unprotected?
I didn't write that down, but that was my first thought. Why are they not in their sheaths on their backs?
I just want to take this out and set this on this random table for a little while. I'm tired of carrying this. Nobody watch it. Well, Orko, kind of keep an eye on it. But and then we're going to set them both together. Like, let's set the two most important things on the same table and not pay attention to it. Those Monstroids look ridiculous.
They
that
do.
That was not good from a design standpoint. Ice donuts that don't melt, apparently, because they stayed the same size basically for the purpose of the story, and they should have been melting constantly. And I don't understand how the ice donuts are working.
I don't either.
I don't get it.
I mean, they do try to explain it with the whole fulcrum and pulley and lever and whatever
but
else.
It doesn't have to be ice. They could have just thrown a rock.
Yeah, I know. Oh, no, it did have to be ice, because part of the story was that the Monstroids basically run on heat.
It was lame.
So they had to find a way to cool.
Stretch.
Yes, I'm not saying it's not lame. I understand that. I agree with you. It's lame. But that's why they needed to use the ice.
And the symbol of the rebellion. Give me a fucking break. They had the thing, and they're calling it, like, this can be the symbol of the rebellion.
Oh, the flower and the rock, yeah.
To vomit. So, what else do you have for phrase on anything?
If there was going to be a symbol of the rebellion, why don't we just go over to Eternia and call the widgets and have them get their He-Man signal? I mean, that's a symbol. I mean, come on now.
Sword or Statue of Adora or something like
that. Something. Okay, I know Orko's magic is never supposed to work quite right outside of Tralla. I get that. But I didn't even think Madame Raz was going to be in this episode, because they essentially give him a Madame Raz thing where he supposedly says the wrong word. Like, she does that all the time, because Broom always corrects her. And her spells usually end up working out, even if she did say the wrong word. And they gave that to Orko, and I'm like, okay, I understand what you're doing, because you're trying to get rid of the... But I would have rather had some Etherian eagle or bird or dragon or somebody come by and just pick the damn things up. And again, why the fuck are you having the damn power swords just sitting out there on the table? I mean, come on now.
Anything else?
And who the hell wrote this? Seriously. Like, why? Like, we're on episode 75 of this series. We're on episode 75 of this cartoon series. There is 21 cartoons left out of the 93 that we still have to talk about. And they have Dumford or Darnford or whatever the hell, King. Who the hell is this guy? Do you got anything else? Because I'm going to take a moment here. I want to see if I can find something on this guy.
The other thing to mention that we always do is the PSA is about believing in yourself. So, you know, Orko's got to believe in himself to kind of get the swords back. And when he's doubting himself, that's when he's failing. So that's the lame PSA for today. Other than that, I don't really have anything else. I mean, it had the pieces to make a good episode, and I just feel like it failed on so many levels.
Yeah. According to Durnford's King's filmography on IMDb, he started out writing. He wrote a few episodes of Heathcliff and the Cadillac Cats. So there's that. Then he was a writer on Ghostbusters, the 86 series, which I believe is the Filmation series. And then the real Ghostbusters, he wrote one episode. Wrote one episode of Dino Saucers. Thankfully, this is his only She-Ra episode.
Thankfully. We won't have to hear about him again. So, all right, we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll let you know exactly how we rate this episode and if there's anybody worthy of these protection swords that we're not really keeping good track of.
Highlander the TV series, Highlander the Raven, girl. Durnford, get a real job.
Adam, we can't let them destroy Flower Mountain. Our people will lose heart, and the rebellion will fail.
Well, I think it's time She-Ra and He-Man made their appearances. Our swords! They're gone!
Gone? But how? Orko!
Orko, were you fooling around with these flowers?
Ah, you noticed!
Our swords were on that bench. Now they're gone.
Your swords? But I wasn't... I mean, all I was doing was changing some flowers and making others disappear. Oh, no. You don't mean that I...
Quickly, Orko, bring our swords back.
Oh, bring them back. Yeah, right. Let's see. I was doing a changing size spell and a changing color spell.
Try one of them, Orko.
Right, Adam. Oh, my dear. Point my finger and swords appear! That's it. I was doing a trick shot. A tickety, tickety, yakety, yak. Cast the spell behind my back. Gee, I've been looking all over for that.
Orko, our swords.
The monstroids are getting closer. Come on, Adam. I think it's going to be up to Adora and Adam.
I think you're right. Keep working on it, Orko.
All right, we're back to hand out some hardware. Mr. TFG and Mike, do you have any horde bats or protection swords to give out?
Originally I wasn't going to, but now that we've talked about it a little more and I've done some research, I'm going to give, and I don't care what you say, you're going to have to actually put this in here, but I'm just going to give you one number. I'm going to give Durnford King 1,000 horde bats because, oh my God, what is wrong with this guy?
Like, so the writer gets a horde bat.
1,000.
Writer gets a horde bat.
1,000. Add those three zeros. protection swords, I will give one to Orko because, like I said, I like that they're sticking with Orko being able to walk through and do what he's supposed to do, not just shirk off the responsibility of losing the power swords. And again, Orko knows the secret.
Right.
Orko, you know, Sorceress, Man-at-Arms, and Orko were the three that knew the secret in, you know, in He-Man. So, of course, he's going to want to do his best. So I'll give a protection sword to Orko. What about you?
I do not have any protection swords. I didn't think anybody deserved it in this episode. But I do have two. Well, actually, I have three horde bats. Adam okay. and Adora for not keeping better hold of their swords.
Yeah.
And then Orko for losing them. So he does get them back, so he gets a less of a horde bat, but big time horde bats for Adam and Adora for losing their swords.
Yep.
You can't lose the one thing that's giving you your power. Come on now. How about for a rating? What do you got for this one?
There's
still castles.
It just... If it was a better written story, if something else happened, if the robots' monsters were slightly better, it would be more around the lines of like a 3.5, but it's a 1.5. Because like I said, the only thing that's good about this, the only two things that are good about this is the Orko characterization and the whole making the brother and sister do 90% of the episode. So 1.5 Crystal Castles.
All right. I'm pretty much the same as you. I got a 2, though. Just for the potential that it could have had and for the fact that we do have a crossover and we do have the swords missing, but man, everything else was terrible. So I can only go as high as a 2, and that's being very generous. All right, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to come to the most weird name for a episode that I've seen so far in our entire journey through these Powers of Grayskull. Brigis is coming up, episode 76.
Haggis! I want some haggis! Not really. Throw all that into a sheep's stomach and cook it up. Ugh.
Here is the place I told you about, Hordak.
Excellent!
Shadowing. What is that glow on the view screen? A place where there is great magical power.
And soon I shall have that magical power.
But that's nothing but an empty field. Yes, except for one day every 500 years. Many years ago, the chief of the village of Brigis made an agreement with a powerful and good witch to use his village to take care of the witch's box of magical power.
And if we guard this box, as you ask?
Then, Brigis will live forever, moving slowly through time. It will reappear for only one day every 500 years.
And we shall have continued happiness and health?
Yes, but remember, if any member of the village ever leaves, the spell will be broken and the village will be doomed.
But if the village is only here for one day, you won't have time to get the witch's magical power source.
Oh, yes, I will. The spell will be broken when we capture somebody from the village.
All right, up next is episode 76, Brigis. Saturday. This one, according to some sources, actually goes back and was aired before here, back in, or actually the next year, September 1987. It's one of those that I'm not really sure if it did not air until the following season as kind of a holdover, or
right.
My sources are just wrong. Writer was Coslow Johnson. The village of Brigis houses a great magic box and appears for one day every 500 years. Hordak attempts to break the spell by kidnapping a little girl from the village. We have Catcher, Hordak, Imp, Shadow Weaver, Mantenna, and Grizzlor. We have She-Ra, Madam Raz, Bo, Cowl, Broom, Swiftwind, and then we have the Brigis people. So what did you think about this mysterious village that appears once every 500 years?
Before I get to that, seeing as how you said his name first and I want to get through this and I looked it up right now, let's talk about Mr. Johnson here, and no, we're not talking about that third-party presidential nominee here. he started out writing one episode of Bewitched in 1966. He wrote six episodes of The Monkees. He wrote apparently all 66 episodes of Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In'. Let's see here. Bunny O'Hare screenplay in 71. The Sonny and Cher Comedy Hour, 58 episodes, 71 to 74.
It looks like a lot of comedy stuff.
Yeah, pretty much. New Adventures of Tom and Jerry in 80. So there's that. Mighty Mouse and Heckle and Jekyll. Sport Billy, whatever the hell that is.
That's another animated show.
Yeah, no, I knew it was animated. We've heard of him before. Yeah. He wrote Game Plan. Wow, I did not. Okay. He wrote the two of the five openers for Voltron, Flintstones Kids, and the last thing, according to this, that he wrote was for Bravestar.
Interesting.
He hasn't been doing a lot lately, and it doesn't say here that he has passed away, so I assume he's still alive.
All right. Well.
But yeah, Brigis, I like this one. I think this one's interesting because you have, we've been talking about the last, three or four podcasts or so of various areas and towns and villages on Etheria. What I like about this is you basically have one that doesn't come around for every 500 years.
Right.
I know that's technically a lame-ass plot, but it's interesting to see where stuff like this is going to show. This, to me, finding hidden villages on Etheria is better than trying to look for Lukey.
Yeah,
it's true.
I don't know. I guess I do understand the once every 500 years part and kind of the mystery aspect of it. I don't know. This didn't do a lot for me, though, just because I felt like it was another one of those kid episodes where we have this Jareen who was annoying as shit to me, and I just wanted the village to disappear again and not see it for 500 more years. Anything else to add before we make our way to Fright Zone?
No, let's go.
All right, we're going to take a quick break and head to the Fright Zone and the Whispering Woods another time.
I call this my backup shot.
And I call that good shooting, Bo.
And I call that rotten flying, Madam Raz.
Mantenna, what are we looking for?
I don't know. Shadow Weaver just said we should capture somebody from this village.
Oh, yes, for certain. What village?
It's supposed to be here. There it is.
Wow.
We have to bring someone back to Shadow Weaver. That little girl will be perfect. I'll go get her.
All right, Mr. Mike, anything for the Whispering Woods today that you liked a lot about Brigis?
You said it at the end of the of the introduction here of the plot that certain things you absolutely didn't like, and I can't believe I'm saying this, but finally a kid that doesn't annoy me is all hell. Like, I really can't believe I'm saying she wasn't like Cousin Jeremy. She wasn't like for me it was once again Masters of the Universe teaching me not to talk to strangers. Like, I'm sure we're going to go through your negative points on her and all that, which we are, but it's one of those things where at first she's like, yeah, no, I'm not going with you. You know, so that kind of thing, and even though obviously it doesn't end up staying a thing, because she does end up going with them, but at first I really did enjoy her. I didn't really have too much of an issue with her voice, also I thought, as I mentioned earlier, it was an interesting concept with every 500-year village. Other than that, let's go to the Fright Zone. Before you start, because I know you're going to have a long tirade here, I'll just run through mine. Mantana the Creeper. Somebody cue Rob Zombie, please. Shadow Weaver the Creeper. and honestly, I was really disappointed with this. I thought the little girl was going to turn into Glinda the Good Witch. Because they essentially say that the chick that made the deal with them was a Good Witch. And whenever I hear the name Good Witch, all I can think of is friggin' Wizard of Oz and Glinda the Good Witch. I was disappointed that the little girl did not turn into the Good Witch. Like, I thought that was a whole plot MacGuffin that was going to happen, and it didn't friggin' happen. Okay, so yeah, go ahead. What's your tirade here?
I don't have a lot here. I just wrote down that this is creepy as hell. The whole episode was creepy, especially when they're trying to kidnap this little girl. Hordak was creepy. Everybody involved was creepy. Jareen's accent, it was like she was Haji from Johnny Quest. I don't know what that was. I guess they were trying to make it seem like that these people were exotic of some sort. But overall, I just found the episode, two words for me describe Brigis. Creepy and boring. That's where I was with it. I thought there was a lot of creepy moments, and then overall I just was kind of bored with it is the biggest thing, because I just didn't feel like it did much with anything. Like, we have a lot of different characters involved with, you know, five or six Horde members and five or six Rebellion members, and they just didn't, I don't know, it just, outside of the mystery of this village that comes and goes every 500 years, that's about the only good thing I could find for it.
Yeah, and I'll say this, I mentioned the Good Witch here, but the Good Witch was voiced by Melindy Britt, because it's clearly a She-Ra voice or an Adora voice. I did not like it, because they tried to, like you said, they tried to foreignize it. They tried to have her make some sort of, you know, Haji. And it's funny we're talking about Johnny Quest, because as we're recording this episode, I just have to throw this plug out there, but as we're recording this, La La Land Records just released for the first time ever a 2-disc release for the Johnny Quest music from the cartoon series, so that's awesome. But it's one of those things where, as much as I love Melindy Britt and her other voices and Adora and She-Ra, that voice for the Good Witch was just a little strange for me.
Yeah, did not like it. So, and the PSA was, don't break the rules. Shouldn't break rules.
If you don't break the rules, you know, God. Sometimes rules are meant to be broken, and the sad thing is, the first thing I think of when you say that is friggin' Jessica Biel in 2001, Summer Catch. If you want big rewards, you gotta take big risks.
There you go. All right, so let's take another break, hand out some more hardware, and see if we like this one more or less than the Flower Day one.
Your name, and where are you from?
My name's Jareen, and
from the village of Brigis.
There's that rebel, Adora. Wouldn't Hordak love to have her for a present?
But Shadow Weaver wants us to capture someone from the village.
Fool! Adora's twice as valuable as the girl. Let's get her!
All right, it's time once again to hand out some horde bats and protection swords. We'll start with you. What do you got, horde bat or protection sword?
Horde bats to everybody.
Horde bats to everybody. 1,000 of them or just one?
One horde bat each to every single person, whether they're fictional or not, that worked on this episode. Because, oh my God. Like, I get it. There's certain things, like I said, I liked about this, but there are no character moments here that really stand out. Like, She-Ra doesn't do any epic swinging. She doesn't, you know, none of that.
I have one specifically that I'm going to give out, and that is to Mantenna for being creepy as hell. So he was the creepiest out of the creepers, so I will give him my specific horde bat. And I have no protection swords to give out to anybody. Episode rating, what do you give this one?
A one. Yeah.
Just slightly worse than the first episode today.
Well, we can't give like triple zeros on this show, but yeah, a one.
All right. I am exactly where I was with you on last one. I'm a half step ahead. I'm a 1.5. So, 1.5 for this one out of 5. Not a good episode. Let's hope the last one will be a little bit better as we take a break and come back with episode 77 next.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Rob Zombie.
Ready to go, Hordak.
You have been my best servant, Shakra. You have done well for me all these long years. Please accept this pendant as a token of my appreciation.
Thank you. I must say, this is a surprise coming from you.
No one understands the real me. They all think I'm mean and cruel. In reality, I'm a kind, generous, wonderful person. Don't you think so, Shadow Weaver? Don't you think so?
Oh, of course.
Well, goodbye and good luck, Shakra. That miserable Shakra is a traitor.
She doesn't think we know that she intends to join Adora and the Great Rebellion.
Don't worry. With the help of the pendant we gave her, we'll soon know everything about the Rebellion. And I will personally supervise their downfall.
All right, last up today is episode 77, The Caregiver, written by J. Bryn Stevens, who we've talked about many times before, air date somewhere around Friday, November 8th, 1986. Shakra, who took care of Adora during her years at the Fright Zone, leaves the Horde to join the Rebellion, but Hordak has given her a magic amulet, which he uses to keep track of Shakra and the Rebels. So we have Shadow Weaver, Hordak, Catra, Mantenna, Grizzlor, She-Ra, Spirit, Swiftwings, Glimmer, Madam Raz, Bow, Broom, and Chakra. What do you think about this lost servant of the Horde?
You've got to be kidding me. I'll get into this more when we get to the Fright Zone, but you've got to be kidding me.
Not a big fan?
No, not at all. Because Mr. or Ms., I forget if we figured out if Jabron Stevens is male or female.
Male. He's male.
Okay, well, I don't know. This day and age, you know, you got vice versa's and whatever. So, this... He essentially... And I don't know if Lou Scheimer or Erica Scheimer, whoever gave him this script or told him to write... Whoever told this person to write this script, they should have looked at their own fucking continuity.
Yeah. Oh,
God, just...
That good, huh?
And no.
All right. Well, I mean, I don't mind the fact that we have something that's, you know, from, you know, somebody else that's in the Horde that we don't know about that has a connection to Adora. Like, that's all fine and dandy. The biggest hole with this is you can't introduce this character that's been Hordak's longest servant that we've never fucking seen before.
Yeah.
So if this was a character that for some reason was just seen in the background before, or just like this, you know, non-speaking, just like, you know, wallpaper type character that we've gotten glances of from time to time, and now they're going to do an episode focused on her, that would be cool. But we've never seen her before, so there's no way she's Hordak's longest working servant or whatever. So that's the biggest problem with this plot. Other than that, if it was a character that we'd seen before and that now we're getting a central plot based on that and she's defecting, then I'd be all for it.
Yeah.
So, all right. Well, let's take a quick break and see what exactly we liked and disliked about the caregiver.
I've blown up the Whispering Woods for this, folks. We're going straight to the Fright Zone. Fuck this show.
When I left the Horde, I was afraid I would never see you again. Oh, hush, my child. I'm here now, and you won't ever have to leave me again.
I hate to interrupt, Adora, but we've got business, remember? We have to leave for you know where.
This woman raised me from the time Hordak stole me as an infant until I left the Horde. She was there for me when I was sick or afraid. Chakra was all the mother I had until my brother Adam found me. I have no secrets from her, Bo. Chakra, we're going to attack the Horde robots.
I'm going to pull a Whitney. I have nothing, so...
All right, we're back for the Fright Zone moments. I didn't have anything for Whispering Woods, so we didn't stop there. But I did, like I said, I like the idea of Chakra if she had been somebody we'd seen previously. For Fright Zone moments, Hordak's most trusted servant we've never seen... Where was She-Ra running after Hordak left? Because she's seen in one shot right next to Chakra, and then all of a sudden she's running to them, which was weird because she was already there. So she ran to a place that she was standing 2 seconds ago. And why was she ever a servant there? She doesn't show any signs. It's not like it's a bad character that then is turned good. She seems like she's a good character from the beginning.
Yeah.
So why was she a servant for Hordak? It's not like they're not showing that she was forced to be. She was never in any type of shackles or, you know, there wasn't like this slave type aspect to it. It's like, oh, I was a willing servant and I worked for Hordak for a while and, you know, I've been there forever even though I'm a good person. Like, I don't quite understand
her character. Yeah, and the other thing is now all of a sudden she wants to change sides and go to the rebellion. That's not even explained.
Right. So it just seems like she would have always been a good person the whole time, but she didn't. It was never shown that she was forced there. She was there, you know, beyond her will or, you know, against her will or anything like that. So I was just kind of thrown off by that.
The only Fright Zone moment I wrote down is, so the nanny has been there the whole damn time, yet in Secret of the Sword, they explicitly say that Shadow Weaver was not like a... Wasn't she like a mother to Adora? Didn't she take... like? So who's supposed to be taking care of Adora? Is Shadow Weaver supposed to be the nanny? Or is this chick, this lady, supposed to be the nanny? And Shadow Weaver and Hordak went off on Horde Prime's Horde World to have a Horde holiday. I don't even know anymore. Because it's like... That's what I was saying earlier in the plot. That they... This writer came up with this story to shoehorn this character in to basically uncreate... the continuity that was already existing in them saying that Shadow Weaver was the one that took care of Adora as almost as a mother figure. And this episode. Just no.
No?
No, no, no. No.
All right. In the PSA was about not judging people quickly, give them a chance, because obviously one part of the episode is Madame Rez, pooping on Chakra and saying, how can you trust her? And she's evil and it's her fault and blah, 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 which we've seen multiple times throughout the series where you have an outsider that's kind of accused of being a traitor or accused of being bad, and then they have to prove that they're good. We've seen it like at least three times just in She-Ra alone, so... We get it.
More than that, yeah.
Don't judge a book by its cover. Give people a chance. Yep. All that jazz. So we're going to take a quick break, come back with our final ratings for the last episode today, The Caregiver.
That's one trooper out for repairs. Mantenna, what are you doing here?
We surprise you!
Going my way?
Ah, Adora! What a prize to bring back to Hordak!
It's a trap! Run!
All right, it's the last chance to hand out hardware, horde bats, protection swords. Mike, you giving out any?
I gotta give a horde bat to Madame Rez. As much as it pains me to do so, she went judgmental way too fast.
Yeah, I can totally see that. I didn't have that down, but I totally agree with you on that one. My horde bat goes out to Chakra, because if you're that good of a person and you have all these good intentions and all this other stuff, why have you been a servant for Hordak for all these years? Tell me. And if you were willing, then what made you change to the good side? I have no idea what your motivations are. So you are a bad character, so I give you a horde bat.
And I'm also going to give a horde bat to the writer, because this episode should not even friggin' exist. It just shouldn't.
Yeah, true enough.
Continuity-wise, it should not exist.
How about Crystal Castle, sir? What do you give this one?
Zero.
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 See, I did, even though I had the problems with it as far as Chakra and all that, I actually did find it more entertaining of an episode than the other two today. So I am all the way up to a 2.5 on this one, because I just found the actual action of the story more entertaining, and the go back and forth between the Rebels and Hordak and stuff like that, and I do like the idea of there being a connection. It's just there's some minor problems with it, but I enjoyed it the most out of these episodes today, so 2.5.
Zero.
All right, so a disagreement on the last episode, but regardless, no good ratings for today's episodes. It's not a good day in Etheria. So we're going to take a quick break and try to get out of Etheria as fast as possible. We're sprinting for the finish line, folks.
Hello, geeks and geekettes. Looking for a podcast that covers a vast array of topics? Then check out Altered Geek Unleashed, where we discuss our thoughts on this week's geeky news, tech, gaming, television shows, movies, cartoons, comics, and more. So, get altered, get geeky with the Altered Geeks, every Friday on the GeekCast Radio Network.
Because the world needs another movie podcast.
The GeekCast Radio Network presents for your listening pleasure, The Cinema Geek.
Hosted by Amanda, Kevin, Matt, and Dan.
Each week we dive headfirst in the landscape of movies as we discuss movie news, play movie games,
go in-depth on reviews,
and even have a top 10 countdown or two.
Also, don't miss our director retrospective series, where we review noted directors' movies film by film.
Bottom line is, if you love movies and love podcasts, you need to experience The Cinema Geeks.
You can find us on iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, or GeekCastRadio.com.
I know what we're doing today.
Okay, Michael, if we're going to tackle this podcast thing, we've got to do something really special. It has to be cool, daily, in audio form, and undetectable by radar. Something that screams summer. I know, let's do a Phineas and Ferb review podcast. We'll call it the Podcast Organization Without a Cool Acronym, or POLCA for short. What do you think?
I think if we're not careful, Candace is going to bust us.
You can find Palka on the GeekCast Radio Network, iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, and all of the other methods you find podcasts.
Okay, then. Carry on.
Do you like retro cartoons? Then Saturday Morning Rewind is the podcast for you. Join them each month as they talk about classic cartoons and interview legendary voice actors like Jim Cummings.
I am the terror that flaps in the night.
Corey Burton.
Sometimes flies can be so flighty.
Rob Paulsen.
Sure, Blaine, but how are we going to find chaps our size?
Nancy Cartwright and many more.
Eat my shorts.
So grab a bowl of Lucky Charms.
They're magically delicious.
Put on your hammer pants. Go to SaturdayMorningRewind.com. And be prepared to feel like a kid again. Once again, that's SaturdayMorningRewind.com. Saturday Morning Rewind was voted best podcast ever by its host, Tim Nidell. So it's got to be good.
All right, we are back here on the Myths of Etheria inside the Powers of Grayskull series on the GeekCast Radio Network. We're at episode 72. Very disappointing set of three cartoons today. For me, they got worse and worse. And I understand that back then, continuity wasn't a thing. Like, okay, sure, it was in certain things, but not a lot of cartoons had a strict continuity like they... Like, He-Man and She-Ra now, or He-Man and She-Ra then, are not like He-Man in 2002 from Cartoon Network, where they start out with a story and then they go through and the whole thing... I understand that, I get that. But as I said before, if Lou Scheimer or whoever the hell was given this right, told this writer to write this story, they shouldn't have even done that, because it essentially takes away any and all continuity from the beginning of the damn thing, saying that Shadow Weaver was the damn name. I don't know, but yeah, these episodes have got to get better.
Yeah, like I said, otherwise it's going to be a sprint to the finish line. I need to see something. Because otherwise, man, we got 10 podcasts left.
Of She-Ra, yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be a sprint to those final 10 unless they can stall me along the way and throw something that's going to distract me or something like that. And then they'll do it right at the end, and I'll wish they could do it a little bit longer or something. I don't know, but not a good episode group today.
People, I swear, if this show makes him leave like he left Mask, I already have a backup for him just in case, but damn it, if this show does that, I'm going to be so pissed at Lou Scheimer. I don't care if he's dead or not.
I don't think it'll happen during She-Ra. We'll have to wait to see either one of us after the new adventures.
If I have to suffer through new adventures, so do you. All right. Thank you for listening to the Myths of Etheria. If you'd like to get in contact with us or leave feedback for the show, there are several ways to do so. Visit the website, geekcastradio.com, where you can comment on this and all of our other episode posts. Send us email, feedback@geekcastradio.com. Leave the show feedback in iTunes. Please do this. Follow us on Twitter, @PowOfGrayskull is the show Twitter. You can follow @GeekCastRadio for all of the network updates. Mine is TFG1Mike. What is your Twitter?
OptimusSolo.
Become a fan on Facebook. Go to facebook.com/GeekCastRadioNetwork. We hope you enjoyed the myths today, and don't forget to join us on our next adventure, when we will take a look at the final to... No, that's not right. At the next three episodes of She-Ra Princess of Power Season 2, 78, 79, and 80, which are when the Whispering Woods last bloom... Is this supposed to be Lost Bloom?
No,
not Last
Bloom. When Whispering Woods last bloom.
Okay. I'm not reading that properly. These episodes have really screwed me here. Romeo and Glimmer. Oh, hell no. Get your Shakespeare out of my She-Ra. Ew, that sounds so wrong too. And then we have the Perils of Penelope. I'm sorry, the Perils of Peekaboo. So at least Peekaboo gets her own. Another of her. We had her origin earlier, and now she gets another episode that's supposedly all about her.
There we go.
For now, I am TFG and Mike with
the Suffering Optimus Solo.
Suffering. You don't know what suffering
She-Ra
is.
She was suffering through Optimus Solo.
You don't know what... Did you even watch New Adventures as a... You
we're
have no
to.
Idea
what's... We're about to.
I know we're about to, but did you ever, as a child...
I didn't even think that was a thing.
Okay, see, I did. You don't know what... You think this is bad? Just wait.
You're gonna see me on a soapbox probably every episode. It'll be my it'll be the way I vent out my frustrations throughout the week.
Oh shit! By the power and for the honor of Grayskull, you all have the power.
Skype sucks. Amen.